Here we are, turn two, and it's back to the gun and searchlight phase. So what we've got to do is roll for this guy and see if he is going to come back into action. So 2d6 gets us 8. So it tells you on it, 2 to 7 resume, so he's still disrupted. For the other lights, let me just grab one here for the way over yonder. And try and get it to focus. There we go. On the right-hand side, you'll see it says D, C, and B. That's the three areas that particular light in top left 142. That's the three areas that light can shine on. D, C, and B. So I'm going to put this guy back, preferably in the right place. And we're going to roll for the four lights to see where they're going to illuminate. So we roll 1d6, and 1 to 3 means the first letter, 4 and 5, second letter, 6, the last letter. So we're going to go for, let me just find them and move up. We're going to go first for this guy to see where he's going to illuminate. So we have 3. So he is going to illuminate area Z because 1, 2, 3 is Z, 4, 5 is A, 6 is 3. So let me just find his marker. 4, 1, 2, 4, 1, 2 now illuminates area Z, which is here. Yes. So that's one of them. Let me find. There's only going to be another couple because that one's disrupted. There's the other one there. This guy right here. He is going to illuminate two. So he is going to illuminate section four. So he's 4, 3, 2. Where is he? He is going to illuminate section four, which is here. This whole big chunk at the top is section four. So this guy is lighting up this whole top section. The bottom guy is disrupted, but there is a guy over here. He says knocking everyone over, which is the guy I was showing you in the example, and he is going to illuminate 6. So he's going to illuminate B, which is 142. He's going to illuminate B right where all of our boats are. Surprise, surprise. And the other one in 342 is the guy that's disrupted. So he's doing nothing. Right, so that's the lights done. Back to another naval attack phase. Naval attack phase, same as last time. It's an automatic hit on the Campbelltown. So it will be, whoops, 7. And 7 was an evade, but in the case of the Campbelltown, it's another multiple casualties. There's going to be nobody left on me. It's going to be a whole pile of ghost ships at this point. Let's see, 3. So again, I'm going to have to take off Campbelltown. Where are we? So we have to do 1, 2 crew on the ship, and one comes off of a commando. So I'm going to pick Roy as the victim commando because he doesn't have a primary target. Right, since Roy has took a hit, and yeah, okay, I forgot for the other guys, I just remembered. But when you give a hit to one of the commandos, you also need to roll 1d6 to see if they lose any ammo. So for Roy, it's a 4, and he has 5 strength left, so he's okay. I think that's right. I'm going to double check though. I'm going to double check because I may have just goofed it. If the dice roll is less than the strength, then you lose one. So he does lose one ammo. I am wrong. Damn it. Oh well. Roy loses one ammo. I'll be fair, I'm going to do one for Walton as well. He gets a six, so that's okay. And one for Byrne, who also took hits, and he again is okay. So it's only Roy that lost one ammo because of that hit on the Campbelltown. Right, Harbour Defensive Fire. Back to more of that. Let's have a look. Right, now we're back to the Harbour Defensive Fire, which is the crazy bit where the Germans can, in theory, hit us 12 times. Right, let's see. They still need to get five or less for a hit. The next turn it will change, but for the moment, a six, we're off the hook. So five or less on the red is a hit. So, oops, that was a one. Six. That was a six. So we actually did not get hit whatsoever. That's just insane. But I'm gonna go with it because I need all the help I can get. So the Germans got absolutely no hits, which is just incredible. But as I say, I'm not going to knock it back. Right. Covering fire is where we get to shoot back. Hopefully, we can get luck where we can shoot five times here. I doubt it, right enough. Right, so we need to get seven or less on the two dice, and we are gonna have to pick some targets here. So definitely this gun is the prime candidate because that is covering that landing spot. So that definitely needs to go. It's got to go. So the only thing we couldn't do is we couldn't pick, say, like this light. This light is disrupted. If something is disrupted or out of action, you can't pick it as a target. So we are definitely picking that guy. I want rid of him. So let's see. Let's see if we can get any luck on this. I doubt it, right enough. I can shoot back. Yep, I can shoot back at searchlight and gun positions. So that's fine. So let's see what I can get here. I'm going to have to move the camera because it's covering my little handy dandy table. Right, the red is the effect. Albeit. Is it? Yeah. So we get six. Six is good. Six is good. And the effect is a four. And a four is the target is disrupted. Not exactly the outcome I wanted, but I'll take it. I wanted it gone, but we'll take it. So, second one is a five. Now, this we need to get six or less on this one, so that is another hit. No, sorry. Duh, looking at the wrong dice. It's still definitely a hit. I am meant to declare who I'm firing at first, which I just realised. Oops. Anyway, I'm going to pick this gun here. He's getting a five, which is the same, disrupted. So, my bad, I never called it first, but oh well. Third. Let's see. Third is going to have to be this gun. And it is, let me see, 7, 6, 5. So we need a four or less. Just have to count this now. 7, 6, 5. Yep, so we need to get a five or less. Five or less. Five or less on the two dice. And we did. Holy Jesus. And we got a four. And again, it is disrupted. So that actually worked out ridiculously well. Fourth hit, that would be 7, 6, 5, 4. So we need to get four or less this time. And we're going to try and take out the gun that's way up here in the corner. So we need four or less on the white and yellow. And we get a six. So that's the end of that idea. But that was still ridiculously good luck. Best I've ever had. So, let's continue on. There's going to be more firing. This time, dockside defensive fire. This is where the guns, which most of which were disrupted, would fire back. So, let's have a look. You've got to start with the zone that's got the most amount of boats, which is obviously B. And we need to look at all of the guns that can fire into B. Now, there's one way off to the top left here that can fire into Z, A, or B. We've got three here that are disabled. Awesome. We have one way over here. Sorry, two over there. And one bottom right. So we've got one, two, three, four. We have four guns that can potentially fire into B. You double check just to be absolutely sure. One, two, three, four. Yes. So we have four that can fire into here. We need to then roll a four or less. Let's see. I think we roll one dice from what I remember, because you're not allowed any more than, I think the maximum is five. Let's see. We then roll triad in the same manner. Yes. So we roll, and the yellow and white dice are going to tell us the target boat. So we have four. So we're going to have to do four roll, four or less. Yep, just double checking this because it keeps catching me out of this one. Yep, so as long as we get four or less, they're going to get a hit. We want a high number on this red dice. Oh, well, that's just typical. Just typical. Four, that'll be a hit, and it'll be a hit on 43, which, unfortunately for him, is the Stevens again. Stevens again gets hit. What is this? Why are they picking on the Stevens? Let's see. So it is there, it is then damaged. We then roll the two dice to see what the damage will be. It will be three. Fire. Well, that's just great. So the Stevens is now on fire. We need to get... Well, actually, no, we don't. I was going to say, we need to get the crew off of that boat, but there's only one guy left on it anyway. So, I don't know if he's just the unlucky guy or the lucky guy, I'm not really sure. But, yes, the Stevens is on fire, which is not good. We do have a commando on that boat, though. Luckily, they don't have any primary target. We can try and save them and get a couple of points, but really, for the amount of hassle, it's not worth it. Harsh as it may sound, even if we save both of those, the one crew and the one commando, we would get an extra point if we're lucky, if even that. So yeah, the fact that that's on fire, yeah, it's actually not that bad. It'd be worse if it was somebody else who was full strength. Let's see. It also gets, oops, well, I remember, just while I'm looking, it gets reduced speed as well. So, it now can only move one box at a time while on fire. So, that's not the greatest, but as I say, it could have been worse. It could have been another boat. Let's see. All subsequent shots, it receive a minus one. And if it gets another fire result, it will just explode with no survivors. Great. Right, so that, yeah, it's pretty much on fire. It's a boat that's just going to be ignored from this point on, I think. So that is our dockside defensive fire. Right, Zone A. Zone A only has one gun, this guy up here. I should probably have evened this out actually and made it 3 and 2. So I'll maybe do that next time. But we keep going back and forward between A and B here until we get misses. So hopefully we start to get some misses. But they're gonna have to get a one to get a success here. So that should be a miss, I hope. Again on the red dice, three. So yes, so they miss on this one. So this one has already fired and it has missed. So that is good. Next time I'll try and even it out though so that it's 3 and 2. That's probably my mistake. So we go back to B. Okay, again, four or less is a hit. Of course it is. 52. 52 is not in that zone, I believe. No, 52 is right here. But we need to pick one in this zone, so it's whatever is closest to 52. It's probably going to have to be the Tilly. Failing that, it would have to be 40, but there's no 40s. So yeah, it's going to have to be the Tilly. The Tilly takes it. Tilly's going to have to take the hit. Take one for the team. That'll be 8, an evade. So the Tilly is on an evade. But unfortunately, that's not a miss. So we have to keep going until we get a miss. Oh dear. Right. In fact, did I forget to put in? I may even have forgot to put in the minus one for the light. Anyway, again, four or less in the red. Oh, come on, really? 65. 65 is going to take one for the team. 65 is way over here somewhere. So it is going to have to be. 65 is the last boat, so it's going to have to be the knock that takes the hit if it's here. And it's not, so it's gonna have to be the Rodier if the Rodier is in this side, which it is, it's right there at my finger. So the Rodier is gonna have to take the hit, which is 10. Multiple casualties. That's not gonna end well. Let's see. Da-da-da-da. So we still roll the white dice, half it, but there's no commandos, I don't think, on board, is there? Wait, no, there is. Crap. Rodier. The Rodier has got Haynes on board. So, yeah, he's still going to take a hit. It's four, so that's two each. So, the Rodier loses two crew. And Haynes loses two strength and potentially is going to lose ammo. Nope, doesn't lose ammo. Jolly good. Still not a miss though. So, another one, which is a 3. 16. 16 is possibly, yep, 16 is Irwin, it's still on the approach. So it's not going to be the Irwin, it's going to be the rider or the plat that takes it. There's the rider. Yep. Yep, so it's going to have to be the rider that takes this one, which is 7. Evade. So the rider is now also on an evade. All of the boats that I was hoping would go and land and do things are just getting absolutely pummeled. Right. Thank God for that. So that's that done. So hopefully we can get some people and some commandos off those goddamn boats before they all burst into flames. So that will be the end of the dockside defensive fire, where we can now move. Right, time for us to get moving. And I reckon we move these guys first while these two are damaged. I'm going to keep those three to keep torpedoing this guy. If we have torpedoes left, actually, we may not. Now I think about it. Boyd, knock, and win. Because the Boyd, the knock, and the win, we fired them last time. Damn it! No, they don't have torpedoes left. We have the Irwin and the Collier. The Irwin has a torpedo though. Collier doesn't. Right, so the Irwin is going to move in here and going to torpedo one of these guys. The Collier is going to make a run for it, which it can go to, so it's going to go into section B. We'll have to try and keep a tally of who's moved and who hasn't. In fact, I think I will use some markers just to say they've moved. They've moved, and he is going to torpedo one of these guys. So I'm declaring that right now, while I remember. Right. So these three guys can move. These three guys can move. Now, I need to take into account where they need to be. Boyd. The Boyd needs to, doesn't have a place to go. And the Nock doesn't have a place to go. Right, so those are the three that don't have an actual place to go. In theory, I could have one of those rescue those guys in the burning boat. Yeah, I might. There's nothing else really for them to do because there's no soldiers on them. The Platt, Bert, and Bert. The Bert and the Bert are heading for 366, which is way over in C. So they may as well move to C. So they're going to move through B over to C. And I'll put a marker on both just to say they've moved. The Platt needs to be at 336, which is just over here. So it is going to join the other group that are already sitting there, ready for unloading. That's the plan. Yeah, we'll see. That's the plan. But that is pretty much section A. Those three guys don't really have a job, to be honest, at this point. But they do still have guns, so they can still fire on things, I suppose. So they may come in handy. But for the moment, I'll leave them in A. So let's have a look at B. Zone B. Here we are. Right, obviously, Campbelltown is going to go and smash into that barrier. But I'll do that when I get to Zone C. These guys here, these five, and this guy six, they are going to unload here while this is disrupted. Because this is 336, the magic 336. Because, let me just see, double check. 336 is the Platt, Falconer, Collier, Wallace, Horlock, Henderson are all going to unload there. So that's fine. All good. They're in the zone. I think it only takes one movement point to unload. So this guy has already moved, so he can't unload. So he is going to have to just sit there. But We do the unloading next anyway, but we're not going to move these guys. They're going to stay here and do their bit over here. They're good. They can do their bit next. These guys, Rodier, Fenton, and the Tilly, they are all going to go to 366, which is over in section C. So they are all going to move to section C. So let me just move my dice and budge across to section C. These guys don't move, they've already moved. They're done. I'm just going to put a marker on these guys to remind myself. These guys can move two spaces. So they're going to move one into C, and they're going to be quite happy because they're going to unload at 366. And the Tilly is also going to join them. It only has one movement anyway. So they're good, they're done. And my camera seems to not want to focus. There we go. Right. Done. And the mighty Campbelltown Destroyer comes in and then just smashes right into Normandy Dock. On plan, spectacularly, while the Germans just wonder what on earth is going on. So, we've managed to smash that. We've done that. We have to mark on the sheet that two movement points were used. You may not see this though on the sheet. I'll try and kind of crumple it up a bit. And it says here, rammed at speed, and we were at number two. So, mark that off. We were going at speed two, full steam ahead, right into that dock. So that's good. That is pretty much all the movement done. Our little boat that's on fire is still smouldering away. Probably people waving flags and what have you, but in fact, no, what we'll do, right, I've made myself feel bad now. What I'm going to do is we're going to use the 2 points of the win to come over and we're going to rescue these guys. Because I've made myself feel bad now. Can't have that. So I'm going to have to mark it on the sheet. Stevens. Stevens boat. Stevens boat. We have one crew who are going to jump ship onto the win. So I shall try and put this on the sheet in some way, manner or form. There we go. So, this one crew member from the Stevens, he is now going to go to the wind. Where are we? Wind. So he's going to go to the wind as a passenger. Okay, try not to put the pencil through the paper. So, he is now in there. Burn is the commando, and he is also going to move to the wing. So I'm just going to write it in there. Burn. So I'll just say he's moved down. So the Stevens is now officially an empty boat. If it burns and sinks or whatever, my conscience is clear. As long as this guy doesn't get shot to bits, then that would be bad. So, we've done all the movement we can do. Let's do the torpedo attack. Right, Irwin is going to fire its torpedo, the only torpedo it's got, and it's going to fire it on, we'll say, this guy. So, our dice roll is, as it says, minus one. So, here's hoping we can damage this thing further. Three, so that gets us a two. Two is destroyed. So that is beautiful. Destroyed. Love it. Love it when a plan comes together. Next thing I have to do is clear off the evade markers, turn away markers, and then we'll actually do some loading and unloading. Finally. Unloading. Finally, we get to unload some troops. Right, the Campbelltown has now completely embedded itself in the Normandy dock. So we can now unload our six passengers. We have two non-demolition commandos, which I will just refer to as commandos, Roderick and Roy. So we have these two guys, they have now unloaded. Here we have four demolition commandos, which I'm just going to call them demolition from now on. Purdon, Chant, Smalley, and Brett. They are all here as well. And again, they all have places they need to go. And I'm going to have to check on them, make sure I get it right. That'll be a first. Commandos from this little line here are Haynes, Moss, and Hooper. They all land here. And there's two demolition, Pennington and Woodcock. They go there. This group here unloads to this point here, and we have demolitions, Wilson, Swain, Bradley, and we have Walton. I'll just show you these, that Walton is obviously the damaged guy, so he's reduced. The three on the top right is movement, so Walton is down to two movement rather than three. So I'll balance them on there. And the three commandos that go with them, Hodgson, Newman, and Burney. So there we go. That is the unloading. We have unloaded. The only commando that hasn't made it was Burn. He was on, ironically, I've just found out, Burn was on the ship that was in fire. Oh, the irony. But he never made it. But he didn't die because he's on the wing. He's on the other boat as a passenger. So that's the loading and unloading done. Now we'll get to see how the Germans react to this. Right, let's see how the Germans react to us just suddenly unloading a whole pile of commandos. Again, we are on this activation table. Because we're in turn two, it's the dice roll minus two. So let's see. Oh dear. So that's going to be that we have seven. Oops, nearly dropped the dice. Seven means that we have five Germans that we have to place on the map. Right. I shall move this over a bit. You can have a look at the glorious unloading scene while I try and find these five Germans and put them on the map. I'll do it off camera because, as I said before, trying to find the places to put them is just hellish. Let me just show you where the five went. Five or one there. Two, three, four, and five is way up there in the box. So that's the five. Most of them are on the right-hand side, but there are obviously targets there that we need to get to. And they are going to start making their way to the nearest commandos. So let's have a look, see what's next. We're going to have our commandos moving, I think. Right, before we get into the movement, let's see where we actually have to move to. So, these guys here on the very left, they are going to have to get to the yellow markers. So, these guys here, there are four demolition guys. Those four guys are going to have to get to here, up here, over here, and over there. So that's the four that these guys have got to do. These guys here, there's only two demolition guys in this group. And obviously, someone in high command doesn't quite like Pennington. because Pennington needs to go from here way over to there, to that blue marker. Pennington here is not obviously not a popular guy. Woodcock, on the other hand, just needs to get to there. That's him. So I don't know what Pennington did, but it must have been bad. These guys here, again, there's four demolition guys. They need to get to the green markers. So getting to those two is going to be tricky. And it's kind of tricky because once we potentially blow that bridge over there, or the other part of the dock rather, we may not get to this section, but I don't think there's a whole bunch in it, but I'm going to have a wee look. I know there's a couple of places like here and here that are three victory points each. In fact, there are another one, three. Three with three victory points, so that'd be nice to have them. But we need to go and demolish those places that I've marked. We need to demolish them first, then we can go and try and get other victory points. So let's see how we're going to get these guys up to there. Right, let's think about this before we move anything. This one here's 216. 216, this is Smalley, and Smalley is in amongst this bundle, so he's going to be able to move three. Everybody can move three at the moment. Apart from the wounded guy, wherever he is, I don't remember. So to get to 216, Smalley can just go there and there. That's easy. That's only two movement points to get to there. This one is treble two Chant. So Chant can just go there and there. The only problem being that that spot also has two giant machine guns in it. So we have to try and get in there and try and blow the place up. But even when we blow the place up, the two machine guns will still be there. They'll be separate. But we can't blow them up first. We've got to do the objective first. Let's see, this one up here. 253 is Purdon. So he's got to get up there from here. Now, is it going to be easier to go this way up or to go this way up? Bearing in mind that even these three points here, we can't blow them up until we do up there first. So that's a bit tricky. The ones over here, 256, that's Brett. And again, is it quicker to probably go this way? Bear in mind that we also have a German guy here. As soon as we move in here, he's going to start coming towards us. So I think to get to these two, we're better going this way rather than trying to go this way and round that way. But having said that, these bits here are squares. When you move into a square, you get a kind of defensive bonus when you're in a square rather than being in a circle. So it's, I don't know, because if we go this way, we would have to go up here. It's going to take more movement points to get to there. Then we would go across that way. If to get to there, we then run the risk of going through this orange circle, which I'll come to that later on, but you, in fact, you may even see it. There's a gun there that's going to fire into that orange circle if we step in. So it might be better to go this way and then up. So I think we're going to do that. I think we're going to have two guys get to the easy bits and the other two can go the long way. They can maybe take one each of the commandos just to kind of help them get through there and get past this guy. No doubt there's going to be more of his kind popping up. Right, let's have a look at the middle bit. Well, I need to keep that other blue one in focus. There we go. These guys. So Pennington is the unlucky guy that's got to go way up to there, to that blue dot. There is no easy way of getting to that blue dot. And Pennington is obviously going to have to pass here, which is a swing bridge. So he's going to have to get across that swing bridge before we blow it. So Pennington better get past that bridge quick so that we can then use the other chap, I think it was Woodcock, to blow the bridge, which is 211. Yep. And probably, let me see, there's still one, two, three commandos in there as well. So at least one commando can go with Pennington, because again, we've got a guy there. We don't really want to get through the orange. We run the risk of getting attacked by one of these gun emplacements again. So it's a bit tricky. I mean, we've got to go through that one. But as long as we can kind of get through that, then keep away from it, we might be able to make it up there. So, but that's the easy one, but we need to do it last. We need to get Pennington over that bridge first, then blow it. Doesn't really bode well for him when he's on that side, because I don't know how he's going to get back, because we'll have blown the bridge. He's going to have to go the long way, right away up that way and round again. But, you know, while he's up there, he can blow other stuff up as he goes past. It'll be good. Be fine. Famous last words. And let's see, last bit, way over here. Right. We need to go, obviously, from here. We have, let me just find these guys, 336. We have Walton, who's already damaged. He is going to have to go to here, and he's already from 6 strength to 4 strength. And again, if he goes through any of the green, runs the risk of getting hit by that gun up there, I think it is. 331 is Bradley, is going to have to get to there, which should be okay going through there, but again, going to have to watch the green bits. 321, there is Swain. He's going to have to do that. That's another bridge, I think. Again, when that bridge is blown, then God help Pennington, who's stuck up this area somewhere. And this one here is one of the kind of crucial ones that we want. 315. 315 is actually the power station. So we want the power station put out pronto, because when we hit that power station and blow it up, then most, well, all of the lights will go out, and that'll help getting rid of this sort of stuff. So that'll put all the lights out. Some of them might come back on with backup generators, but the majority of the lights go off. So that'll help us, because what's going to end up happening is some of the lights, I don't think there's any in the camera actually. There's one right there, at the very edge of the screen. That light there. That light can highlight areas 4, 3, and 2. So if that light comes on and highlights area 3, any guys that are in this area heading towards those places is going to be highlighted. And it's the same in the other areas, 2 and 4. If again, same for one as well, that any of the lights come on, we get highlighted, we get shot to ribbons. Simple as that. So, ideally, we want to take that out pronto and then get the other three. But again, we have four demolition and two commandos in that group. So, certainly. Couple of commandos can go ahead in case we get any Germans popping up, because that's definitely going to happen. Definitely going to happen. Right, let's see what we can actually do. Right, so far so good. We don't have any Germans in this area, so we're going to start moving these guys. Burnley can move three. When you go from box to box, as long as it has a single line, it's one movement point. If it's like that one, double line, that's two movement points. Three is three movement points. Doesn't help that you've got things like this, a double line road running through there that looks like double lines when it's not actually double lines. Very confusing. I don't know why they never made these white outlines rather than black. Anyway, enough complaining about 1987 when this was made. We're going to go, let's see. We can go certainly one to there. I'm thinking 3-2-3. That way he's in a square. Bit more cover. And if Newman here does a similar thing. 1-2-3. Oops, no. That'd be 1-2. And that's a double line. So what if he goes that way? Just to keep an eye on things. Because in theory, because of the triad rule, a German could pop up anywhere on the entire map. Let's see. Hodgson. So we've got, let's see, where are we? We've got Burnley there. We've got Newman. Yeah, so I've actually got three commandos and four demolitions in this pile. Wondered why there was so many. So Hodgson, where's he gonna go? Go 1-2-3, I suppose. Again, just kind of spread them out a bit. And again, he's in a square, which is a bit more kind of defensive. Now, Walton definitely has to go to 3-4-3, which is up here. So he's as well following Newman. And since he is wounded, put him at the bottom. When the Germans fire, sometimes they'll usually, well, I think it says in the rules from off the top of my head that the Germans will hit whoever's on the top of the pile first. So that's the way I've been kind of ordering it. I might be wrong on that one. Yeah, surprise. And I think we should do the same and just have one and one. Bradley is going to 3-3-1, which is that one up there. I can't go from there to there because that's two. That's 1-2. That'd be 3-4. So we're going to have to kind of scoot in about the corners. Swain is going to 3-2-1, which is way up top. So he can go 1-2. He'd be as well going in there as well. He would be as well going into there. One's going to go that way. One's going to go that way. And Wilson's going to go to 315, which is a power station. So, yep, he can join him in there. And they've all moved three each. So that's that bit done. Right, this is a tricky one. Okay, we've got three commandos and two demolition. So what I'm thinking is, we have Woodcock and he's a demolitions guy, and Hooper, they make their way to this one. So they've got three, which can take them one. Can't go across a dotted line, so you've got to either go this way or round the way here. So that'd be 1-2-3, that'd be 1-2, and then we couldn't move to there. So I think, similar idea, if we move the other demolitions guy, Pennington, who's got the big long journey, if he takes the two commandos, and he also makes his way up that way, gets across the bridge first, that might be a better idea, so that we all move at the same time. So that these guys move. So I'm going to put, I'm going to put Pennington at the top, or in the top bundle, so that he moves first. Then we can blow the bridge. That's the plan. So one into there, double line there, so that takes up the third. So, right, let's see how that goes. Okay, last bundle. Right, let's head for the easy targets first. So we've got 216. 216 is Smalley. That's Smalley's job to get in there. Let's see, where is he? Try and find him, Smalley. So Smalley is going to go 1, 2. And he's already in his place. In here is treble 2, which is Chant. So Chant can go 1, 2, and he's in his place. Let's see what number. 253. Purden. Purden needs to go way up there. So let's do the roundabout route. And we'll do two teams of two that are going to take this route. So they're going to go 1, 2, and 3. So we've got two teams of two, and they're heading towards those two green dots. And this guy's going to get in the way. I just know it. Right. All good. As I say, these things like these double lines that they've got is part of the map. It's really confusing. It makes it look like there's two lines connecting here, but it's not. That's the actual line there. Single line. Right. I think that is all the movement done. And next is time for the Germans to move. That's a shame. Slight change of plan. I just happened to be looking up another rule, and I then come across a rule that says when you first land your troops, you have one movement point less. So I'm going to have to move everybody back one. Dear, oh dear. So that was 1, 2, 3. So I'm going to have to move this guy back to here. These guys are going to have to go back to just here, because they only have two. So they're going to have to move there next time. These two guys are okay. These guys are going to have to move back one. So that's annoying. I wish I hadn't read the rule book now and just went ahead. But there we go. Right, German movement. Let's see what they get this time. Two. So German movement moves to two. So let's see what they can do here. Guy way up the very back. Way up the very back. He has a two. So he equals the movement point, so he gets to move one space. It takes three spaces to get out of those boxes, so he's got to wait until other Germans appear, consolidate, and have enough points to get out of there. So he's stuck, which is good, not complaining. This guy's a two, he gets one movement point, and he's going to move towards the nearest commandos, which isn't really, in fact, he's not going to move either, because he's in the U-boat pens, and it's two movements either way. So he's stuck, which is good again. The guy way up in the very top right corner, he's also stuck, doesn't have enough movement points. Right, these three guys here, this guy can move, he's got a strength of four, so he can move two, which will take him to there. This guy's a four. So, in fact, no, he can move three, actually, because he's got the movement points plus two. Yep, so he can go 2, 3. This guy, same, he can go 3, 1, 2, 3. So that's getting a bit close. And this guy is the same, he can move 3. So that's going to put him on top of his, ah, crap. Right, so he's going to go 1, 2. Oh dear. Right, looks like there's going to be running battles very quickly. Right, that is the German movement. Done. Finally, some action. But first, I need to show you this table. This is the land combat to hit table. And this is going to modify the dice rolls. And you can see here, it tells you if the target is in a square or a triangle or whatever, then they get a defensive bonus. And if your fire is a demolition unit, then you kind of lose a point. So you're better to not use demolitions teams in combat. It's going to have to happen, but it is more difficult to get a hit with a demolition unit. Right, to the action. It is over here in the dock, right next to our big ticking time bomb here. The only main fight is this one here, but you have to tackle whoever is in your area first. Then you can move to a linked area next door, like this guy. We beat this guy, we can potentially take on this guy. So let's have a go. So we just move this over a bit. So again, we roll a triad, and the yellow and white need to be the fighter's strength or less, and the red is going to be the damage done. So let's have a look here. I know that Roy here, he has a strength of 5, and Roderick here still has 6. So he's going to be firing first at this German guy. So we need 6 or less on the white and yellow. So, see what we get here. And of course we get a 7. So we get 7, but remember the table. -1 if the fighter is a commando assault unit. So that's 6. Target is in the same area as the fighter, which the German guy is. So that now makes it a 5 in total. And we're not under any search beams, squares or demolition units, so 5 is a hit. So Roderick comes through, does a hit, and gets 4 damage. So that guy is now reduced to 2. Just replace his marker with a 2. So he's reduced. So let's try our chances with Roy on the same guy. Can Roy come through, do the deed, and get rid of this guy? He gets an 8, which is not looking great. Fires a commando assault unit, so we drop it by 1. Target is in the same area, we drop it another 1. Not in a search beam, not in a square, not a demolitions, so the final result is a 6. Roderick has a 5, so Roderick misses. Right, let's try then with one of the demolitions units. Try with Brett here. Brett still has 6. So I'm going to try with Brett, see if Brett can come through. Oh dear God, no. Brett also gets an 8. And we don't get the -1 for assault unit. German fighter, the target is in the same area. So yes, that drops it to a 2. But the fighter is a commando demolition unit, so that takes it back up 1. So the final result is 8, and Brett also misses. Last ditch attempt, Purden. Come on, Purden, you can do it. Come on, son. 6 or less. And he gets 9, which is even worse. So even on the table, oh, try and get this to focus again. Even on the table, It would still be a non-event. So Purdon also misses. Right. So that is the end of the commando combat. Unfortunately, the Germans also get combat. So that's a bit rubbish. It's also a similar idea though. So by reducing that guy's strength, there's less likely a chance he's going to fire back. Let's see, just double checking this. Yeah, the only difference in this turn, or this case with the German firing, is that our losses obviously go in the sheet, and we could potentially lose ammo as well. The three ammo boxes, I don't know if I mentioned this, they are grenades, which we can use later. So this German guy, he needs two or less on the white and yellow dice. And he's just as bad as us. So, no chance. He misses, doesn't get us. So that is the end of that particular area. But this guy can fire on us, and he's got a better chance of hitting. He needs four or less. Ah, jolly good. He gets an eight. So he also misses. Whew, that was close. Right. Germans are just as bad as us at shooting, which is great. The other thing we need to check for combat is German long range fire, which is the guns I mentioned that can fire into the coloured squares. It's nobody in those coloured squares, so that's not happening, so we don't return mortar attacks. So that's the end of that section. Right, now we can try and blow stuff up in the demolition phase. Our two guys here, they are in place for their particular targets, their primary targets. First thing we need to roll on is this table here for the preparation. We've got to roll one dice. It's got to be less than or equal to our strength, but we have these modifiers. So let's see, we'll go first for Smalley. He's six or less. We got two. That's good. Here we have placing demolition unit entered target area this turn. Yes, he did. So this becomes a four. Placing demolition unit was attacked this turn. Nope. Attack Germans this turn. Nope. Pair functioning enemy unit in same area. Nope. Primary target of assigned demolition unit. Yes. So that's a minus one. So we're back to a three. So that is successful. Splendid. So we have a little marker here for prepared charges, and that is going to go on there. So that's a dangerous place. Next, go for chant. Same again, exact same. We want a low number. Four. End of the turn, we'd make it a six. Nope. 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 Minus one for assigned to that unit, so our final result would be a five. So that's also a winner. Right. Yet more bombs placed. Fantastic. Right. Now, if there was Germans in those areas, you'd have to roll and see if the Germans are successful in removing the demolitions. Because in theory, they can, whoops, come on, focus, focus, behave. There we go. If there was Germans there, they can remove your demolitions and totally foil everything. Hopefully in this case they don't. So, next, do they actually blow up? Will we cause a big bang? Right. Will the demolitions go off and do a damage or destruction? We need to roll on this table this time, over here. So again, We're just going to roll here. It's nothing to do with strength or anything. So, come on. We want to blow things up. One. Yes. 1 to 3. Destroyed. Target was previously damaged. Nope. North or southern caisson. Nope. Charges at risk. Nope. Detonated by an assault unit. Nope. So one is destroyed. So that area is destroyed. And we get the victory points for it. So I'll move them around off camera. And next one. Same again. 2. Perfect. That is also destroyed. So we're going to chalk up some victory points. Fantastic. Okay, there's no German units that are on top of each other that can be consolidated into one unit. So that is the end of turn 2. Here is how it looks at the end of turn 2. One building got us 6 victory points, the other one got us 4. So we now have 10 victory points. A whole 10. Unfortunately, we need 70 to actually win the game. So, yeah, we'll see how that goes. But, Campbelltown, 4 of the crew are gone. We have rammed it. We haven't scuttled the ship. The only other crew damages are 3 to the Collier. The Stevens is only 1, but that was transferred, I believe, to the Wynn, from what I remember. Rodier is missing 2 crew. Irwin, Boyd, and Nock have all used their torpedoes, and the Wynn has used a torpedo. Guns can be damaged on these boats, and when they're damaged here, we have to add them down here, which can then start adding kind of negative points, if you like, to our fighting in the future. So we don't really want damaged guns. That'd be bad. The only commando is Byrne. He is transferred to another ship. And Roy's got some slight damage, Walton's got a bit of damage, and Haynes has a bit of damage. So, most folk landed, and most of them are okay, but we still got a couple of kind of wounded people there. Walton and Haynes, but all in all, so far so good. The turn where I only got 1 hit out of 12 from the Germans was incredibly lucky. I don't see that happening again. So the whole idea now is to get those boats that we have parked up and try and show you without destroying everything again. But the boats that we have parked up, we now need to get these guys out of Dodge ASAP. Otherwise they're going to get shot to ribbons and lose the crew. The crew we want back in the open sea and back to England because we get points for them. Again, not a lot, but it will still add up. So, that is the end of turn 2. And I shall see you for turn 3.